Good evening. Welcome to Heart to Heart. I'm Dave Spector. With me, Dr. Andy Waxler from Burke's Cardiologists. Thank you for joining us. We're live tonight. Phone number 610-378-0426. Tonight, we're going to talk about aortic stenosis, which is a principle of valvular heart diseases, correct?
That is correct.
What are valvular heart diseases, and then tell us what aortic stenosis is.
Fair enough, Dave. Well, I have to apologize. I didn't bring pictures tonight, so I don't have pictures, but I can show you how these things work using my hands, I think. The simple fact is that the heart has four chambers. So the heart is made up of four parts. There's two upper chambers, what we call the atria, and two lower chambers, what we call the ventricles. So there's the left atrium, the left ventricle, the right atrium, the right ventricle. Now, I'm doing this backwards because it's how you would be looking at this, by the way. I do know my left from my right. So what are valves? Well, we have four valves in our heart, and a valve is nothing more than a door. Just like you have doors in your house that separate one room from another room, we have valves in our heart that separate one chamber of our heart from another chamber of our heart. So think of a heart valve like a door. Now, what does a door do, Dave? A door just opens and closes, right? So a door's got a pretty boring life, right? I mean, that's all a door can do. So a door opens, and just like that in your heart, these valves, they open, like my hand, they open, and then blood goes through. So, for instance, let's talk about one valve called the mitral valve. What's the mitral valve? The mitral valve separates the left upper chamber, called the left atrium, from the left lower chamber, called the left ventricle. So blood comes into the left upper chamber. The mitral valve then opens to let blood go through into the left ventricle. Then that mitral valve closes like a door closing, and then blood goes on out to the rest of the body. The way I like to think of it is, Dave, have you ever been to Independence Hall in Philadelphia? Mm-hmm. Or have you ever been, for those of us in our viewing audience, have you ever been on a tour of a house, a big house? What do? They get groups of like 15 people. And you start in the first room, and they say, in this room, this is what happens. Then they move you as a group into the second room, and they close the door behind you because there's another group coming 10 minutes later. So they move you from one room into the next room because there's people coming behind you, and they close the doors so that you don't interfere with the group behind you. They don't hear the noise. Your heart works the same way. Your heart is like a tour going through a house. Blood goes from one room through a door. The door then closes as the blood's in the next room, then keeps going. And that's really exactly what happens.
So these valves only work one way.
Correct. These are one-way
blood
valves.
Blood cannot go back. As long as it's working correctly, it cannot back up.
Exactly right. Okay. You said it. If as long as the valve is working properly, blood doesn't go backwards. However, oftentimes, the valve's not working properly. So, for instance, let's say a person has a leaky mitral valve. I just got through saying that the mitral valve separates the left upper chamber from the left lower chamber. So, now, remember, a valve's like a door. So it opens to let the blood go through, and then it closes. Some people have a leaky heart valve where that valve just doesn't quite close all the way. It misses by a little bit. Now, it's normal, Dave, to miss by a little bit. You know, everybody has like a little teeny, teeny bit of leakage to their mitral valve. We call that a trace, T-R-A-C-E, a trace amount of leakage. That's normal. But what happens if the valve only closes halfway? Remember, the valve's supposed to close all the way like my hands. What if it only closes halfway? That's a problem. And then the blood goes from the left upper chamber through that valve into the left lower chamber, but then it leaks back into the left upper chamber. Patients say to me, well, where does the blood go if it leaks? And I say, does it go somewhere? And I say, no, it doesn't go somewhere. It just goes backwards so that your heart has to pump it twice. And that's the key to a leaky heart valve, Dave, is it takes more energy because your body pumps the blood and then the darn blood goes back and it has to pump it again. So it puts a strain on the heart because you have to do more work.
Okay.
And that's the problem with a leaky valve.
Okay.
There's a lot there.
As a layman and non-medical person, the heart is pumping, pump, so it pumps so much into the atria.
Correct. Correct.
Pumping into one atria or both at the
Does
it go around or does it come, it doesn't come into both at the same time, does it?
It actually does. So blood comes into both atria at the same time. So there's blood coming into the right atrium and the left atrium. Then that blood goes into the right ventricle, the different blood goes into the ventricles. Then that same blood that was on the right side of the body, the right side of the heart, pardon me, goes through the lungs and then goes over to the left.
Okay.
So I will, in 2 months, I'm going to bring charts. So let me just prepare our audience. I came unprepared. I will bring pictures and I will demonstrate this in 2 months. So this is a teaser, isn't that what they say, for the next
So there's a certain amount, theoretically there's like, if this was, pennies, there's a certain number of pennies going atrium to ventricle, atrium, ventricle, lungs, atrium, ventricle, and then out.
Exactly. You got it. It goes on the right side of the
body.
So
if something's leaking, then you're going to have to ship more pennies at some point, and now you got more in the next one, so it's going to have to work harder all the way through.
Correct. So it puts more strain on the heart. The way I like to explain it to patients is it's wasted energy. An example would be we just got through winter. Now, thank gosh it's spring. Let's pretend that you like to keep your house at, I don't know, 65. Let's say 65 for sake of argument. So you set your thermostat to 65, and your furnace is working to keep you at 65. No problem. Say some idiot, I don't say my kids are an idiot. That's not. Okay, say some
I hope they're not watching tonight.
Some irresponsible young kid, like could be one of the Waxler kids, leaves a window open or something, and then you've got heat that's leaking out. So you've got wasted energy. The furnace is working its tail off to keep your house at 65. Some of that heat's going out the window. So what happens, Dave? The furnace has to work harder to keep the house at 65. So the point is, your house still stays at 65, but it's costing more energy from the furnace. So a leaky valve is like leaving the window open in your house. It takes more energy. It's a waste of energy, and that's why if a person has a severely leaky heart valve, what I should make very clear to our audience, Dave, is a slightly leaky heart valve is no big deal. The importance of a slightly leaky heart valve is that you see a cardiologist and you get what's called an echocardiogram, an ultrasound of the heart, every couple of years to keep an eye on it. So the importance of a slightly leaky heart valve is to keep an eye on it.
So when your cardiologist says,
if it's very leaky, then it's a problem.
When your cardiologist says to you, you have a slightly leaky heart valve, do not worry about it. Come back in a year or two or whatever
and
your regular
cardiogram.
Get it checked again.
Right.
Then trust him and it's okay.
Exactly. That is very important because, again, let me say a second time, if a valve is a little bit leaky, that's usually not a big deal right now. So it's nothing to worry about. Please don't lose sleep over it now. However, here's the big however. Don't forget about it and ignore it. Keep an eye on it to make sure that it's not getting worse. And if you start developing shortness of breath or other worrisome symptoms, then you get in to see the cardiologist right away to recheck it. So a minor leaky heart valve, no big deal, but you got to keep an eye on it. A very leaky heart valve sometimes needs surgery to fix it. So, but that's a whole nother issue.
Okay. Aortic stenosis.
Okay. The most important valve problem out there is something called aortic stenosis. What does aortic stenosis mean? Well, I'm going to translate that to English. Aortic means it's the aortic valve. A minute ago, I was talking about the mitral valve. The mitral valve and the aortic valve are the two heart valves on the left side of the heart. There's two valves on the left, two valves on the right. The important ones are the ones on the left, the mitral and the aortic. So it's one of the two important heart valves. And what does stenosis mean? Stenosis just means it doesn't open all the way. Remember, Dave, I said a valve is like a door. And a door really only does two things in life. It opens and it closes. So a valve can only mess up in one of two ways. Either it doesn't close all the way, and that's a leaky heart valve that we just talked about, or it doesn't, excuse me, I said that wrong. It doesn't close all the way, pardon me, is a leaky heart valve. And if it doesn't open all the way, that's a stenotic valve or a narrowed valve. I like to tell patients it's like a rusty gate. It's like a, you know, if you have a gate that just gets all rusty and it doesn't open and you need to put some WD-40 on it, that's what aortic stenosis is. It's a condition that older people get. The valve gets thickened and stiff, and it's really almost gets like rust on it. It's not really rust, of course, but it's almost like your body's kind of natural rust, and it doesn't open as well. That's the problem.
What's the solution?
The solution is usually, if it's mild or moderate in the middle, we keep an eye on it, just like with leaky heart valves. So this is your aortic valve.
Okay, mild leaky valve, you just kind of keep an eye on it.
Mild,
it isn't necessarily going to get worse.
Some people get worse, some don't. You need a heart doctor or cardiologist to keep an eye on it.
Okay, I'm guessing that this stenosis is probably going to continue to get worse.
Most people, not everybody, but most people do get slowly worse over time. In other words, if they're, as years go by, most do tend to progress. Some people progress very rapidly, and that's a problem. Some people progress very, very slowly. In other words, if you're 87 years old and it's only mild, you're probably okay. You're most likely going to pass away from old age or something else before it gets bad. So it probably will progress over time. The key is, how young are, what's your age when it starts? And some people go faster than others, and it's hard to predict who's going to be faster.
Right, but the leaky valve is not as big a concern in general as the stenosis.
Well, I sort of agree with that statement. They both can be problematic. They both can get patients into trouble, and they both can require surgery. So I want to make sure that we make it clear they're both a problem. But the most common problem as people get into their 60s and 70s and 80s is this aortic stenosis. So this, if you were to say to me, Waxler, I've got a patient who's 75 and she has a valve problem, guess what it is? I would say aortic stenosis, because that's statistically the most common valve problem that gets elderly patients into trouble. And it's very common, and it's probably underdiagnosed, and it's probably undertreated. Part of the problem is that the main way to fix it is open heart surgery. And I just got through saying that this is a common condition in people in their 70s and 80s. A lot of 82-year-olds or 85-year-olds are going to say, I don't really want surgery. So part of the way it's undertreated is because the population that gets it often says, at 82, I don't want to have open heart surgery. Some do. Some 82-year-olds say, give it to me, bring it on. And some say, are you crazy? Leave me alone. It's funny. I would say, as a physician, as a cardiology physician, I would say people in their 80s that have this, it's probably about 50-50. About half the people say, of course I would want that. Why would I not want that? The other half say, leave me alone. So it really comes down to a personal preference. But up until now, the treatment has been open heart surgery. And maybe we can talk about treatments in a moment.
We're going to take a break here for 30 seconds or a minute or whatever you want.
You're watching Heart to Heart on bctv.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For other information about heart health and fitness, go to bctv.org. Heart to Heart is underwritten by Berks Cardiologists. Program underwriting is a valuable source of revenue for bctv.org. For more information on how you and your business can become program underwriters, go to bctv.org.
Thank you. And reminder, we're live tonight, 610-378-0426, talking about heart valves. We're talking about stenosis and surgical options.
Right. Well.
I mean, do you replace the valve? Do you?
Well, what happens is, as people get older, that valve, remember, it's supposed to open all the way. I tell patients it's almost like it goes from parallel to perpendicular or perpendicular, however. It's like a 90-degree angle. It's supposed to open like this. If it's mild, it may open this far, and then it opens this far. All of a sudden, the valve's only open 5% of the way. So people start to get sick. They start to get symptoms. They get angina, which is like a tightness or pressure in the middle of the chest, or they get short of breath doing real simple things, walking around their house or walking up one flight of stairs, and they say, I never got short of breath doing that. Or they get short of breath laying in bed, and all of a sudden they're sleeping in a chair because they can't breathe when they lay in bed. Or they're having fainting spells. So these are some of the symptoms people get. And then they come to a heart doctor, or the other thing is, sometimes a patient will say, well, my doctor heard a heart murmur. What's a heart murmur? Heart murmur is a sound that a doctor hears with a stethoscope that often is a sign that there's a valve problem. And here's the way I explain a heart murmur.
You ever go for a walk, Dave? You're kind of a, you know, an outdoorsy guy. You go for a walk in the woods, and you come across a quiet stream, and it's not making a sound. Contrast that with going to the Colorado River, where you're going whitewater rafting. So water, if it's moving, can be really quiet if there's no turbulence. It's very quiet. Think of a stream out in the woods. But if there's a lot of twists and turns and rocks, there's turbulence, and it's really loud. The same is true in your heart. Blood is flowing through your heart just like water is flowing through a river. If it goes through those valves smoothly, it's very quiet, and you don't hear a heart murmur when you listen when you're a heart doctor.
But now I'm going to interrupt you.
If there's turbulence,
now,
it's really loud.
Isn't it going into these chambers and then pausing and then going to the next chamber?
It is. It is.
It's not like a constant
flow. So you're right. The blood kind of moves and then stops and then moves and then stops and then moves.
But then the other blood is kind of
As long as
outside your heart, it's moving steady through?
Yes. Well, no. In the arteries, there's a pulsatile blood flow.
Okay.
That's where you feel the pulse. So, yeah, the way our heart works and the way our arteries work is there's a pulse of blood and then a pulse of blood. And you can prove that. Just check your pulse.
Yeah,
you
right.
feel it.
Okay.
So that's how it works. But my point is if the heart valves are opening and closing, it's very quiet. If there's turbulent blood flow, think of the Colorado River, it makes noise, and somebody figured this out like 200 years ago. I didn't figure this out. Some smart person figured this out like 200 years ago, that a heart murmur is a sign of turbulence, and turbulence often is a sign that there's a valve problem. So a heart murmur doesn't mean that you have a problem, does not mean that. But it does mean that you might have a problem, and the way to answer that question is to have an echocardiogram, which is just a simple little 20-minute heart ultrasound. So let's say a person is getting short of breath, or their doctor hears a heart murmur, and they get an echo, an ultrasound, and it shows that that aortic valve isn't opening very well. They have aortic stenosis, severe aortic stenosis, and again, we can grade it as mild, moderate, and severe. Mild and moderate usually mean we just got to keep an eye on it. Severe means you might have a problem that might, keyword, might need to be fixed. Not all severe needs to be fixed. Some severe needs to be fixed. Now, the way to fix it for the last 40 years has been open heart surgery. Well, open heart surgery is a big deal.
And what? You go in and do what?
Well, what they do is they open up the chest. So people talk about the zipper club.
Right.
They open up the chest. You're asleep. You're, you know, unconscious, and an anesthesiologist is taking care of you. So you got an anesthesiologist taking care of you. The surgeon's opening the chest, getting that bad heart valve. They literally cut it out, throw it away, and they put in an artificial heart valve. People say, what's an artificial heart valve? It's actually a little contraption that some smart people invented in the 60s and 70s. And, of course, it's gotten perfected, like cell phones and clock radios and car radios and, you know, cable. Everything's gotten better, so these valves have gotten better. I mean, they were invented in the 60s. Oh, my goodness. I'm on call, and I'm getting paged. Good thing is it's my wife, so we're safe. Anyway.
We're safe. Maybe not you.
I'm in trouble. Now, these valves, there's two major categories of heart valves. There's metal valves, mechanical valves, which are made of titanium and steel. They're metal valves. The good news about metal valves is they usually last forever. If a person has a metal valve put in, he or she is probably set for life. The bad news is they need Coumadin, which is a very powerful blood thinner, or those valves can form a clot. And you must be on Coumadin the rest of your life. Coumadin is a pain in the neck. You have to go get blood tests every once in a while. You might get what we call nuisance bleeding, like nosebleeds and things like that. And you have to, you know, there's always that one chance, I think it's about a 1% per year chance of a serious internal bleed. So again, if you need a heart valve, you got two choices. You got metal valves or non-metal valves. Metal valves, you're probably set for life, but you're probably on, well, you're not probably, you are on Coumadin for life. They make these things called bioprosthetic valves, which are actually tissue. They're actually tissue from a cow or a sheep or horse valve. And the good news about them is they don't need Coumadin, which is wonderful, because some people can't be on Coumadin because it's a blood thinner. What if you have bleeding ulcers, Dave? You can't be on Coumadin. Now, these valves don't need Coumadin, but they tend to start to wear out after about 20 years. So if you're 65, you might say, hey, give me that other valve, and when I'm 85, I won't worry about it.
If you're 30, you're going to say, give me the metal valve, because I don't want to, every 20 years, have to have a reoperation. Where it gets really tricky is if a woman is pregnant. You've got a young pregnant woman, then it becomes a nightmare, because pregnant women can't be on Coumadin, so they don't want a metal valve. But then if you put a 25-year-old woman who wants to get pregnant on a regular valve, she's going to have another surgery probably in 20 years. So this whole valve thing is very complicated. But the take-home message out there for you folks is that this aortic stenosis is very common, and the treatment for the last 40 years, I mean literally since like about 1970 or so, has been open heart surgery. But I've got exciting news. There's exciting news, Dave. It's very exciting. There is new stuff on the horizon, and the horizon is not very far away. There's a very, 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 very smart cardiologist in Columbia, in New York City, named Dr. Leon, L-E-O-N. He and a couple of his colleagues, about 10 years ago, thought of the idea, what if we could deliver a valve, an artificial valve, not a metal valve, this bioprosthetic valve that doesn't have Coumadin, on a balloon and deliver that through the groin, just like we do balloon and stent jobs. Now, we've talked in the past, Dave, we cardiologists can do a balloon and stent job on your heart arteries. So let's say a person has a blockage in their heart arteries. We can go up through the groin and open up a balloon in the heart artery and put a stent in, and that holds open the arteries. And that's gotten really good in the last 25 years, since the 80s, late 80s, early 90s. But we haven't really done a great job in figuring out how to fix valves from the groin. So we can fix blockages in heart arteries from the groin, can't really fix valves from the groin. What they've been doing for 20 years, Dave, is doing a balloon job on this aortic stenosis. Remember I said the aortic stenosis is like a rusty gate, doesn't open so well? Oh my goodness. What we can do is we can do a balloon job where we can open up the valve, with a balloon through the groin, but the problem is it doesn't last very long. It tends to come back in a few months.
Okay. The old treatment was taking the old valve out and replacing it with a metal or
prosthetic valve, a tissue valve
or a metal valve.
Right.
If you're going to come up through the groin, how are you going to take the old valve out?
That's a good question. That's a darn good question. So what this guy, Dr. Leon, has figured out, again, the problem, Dave, before I answer the question, the problem is, what if a person's 80 years old, or maybe not even 80, maybe only 70, and let's say he or she has really bad emphysema so that he or she would not survive open heart surgery. So that's the problem, is a lot of these patients, it's not just an age thing, but it's age plus bad lungs or bad kidneys or something like that, where the surgeon says, I can't get this patient through the surgery because of the lungs. And we've had to say to patients, I'm really sorry, you have this bad heart valve, there isn't much we can do for you because you won't survive surgery.
We can fix your heart and your heart will be great, good as new, but
we can't get you through surgery. Yeah. And so what we've done in those patients is, the usual thing to do is, you don't really do much, but sometimes we can do a balloon through the groin. Now, what Dr. Leon has invented, and which is almost ready for prime time, I think it's within a year of being out, maybe even in Berks County. What he does is he goes up through the groin to that rusty valve that's not opening, and he opens it with a balloon. So he puts a balloon in, and he kind of breaks the rust so it opens. Dr. Pagheri at St. Joe's does that already. So Dr. Pagheri at St. Joe's can do the balloon job and open it up. But the problem is that doesn't last only a few months.
Now he's opening it up, but how does it shut? Doesn't this valve have to shut? It's got to be open and closed?
And that's the problem. So then he goes back up with another balloon, and he actually delivers a valve right where the old valve used to be, and he opens it up in place. And it works very, very well. So he actually can implant. It's unbelievable. The valve is on the balloon, he pushes that up through the arteries into place, then he lets the balloon down and that valve sticks right there. It's incredible.
So he's used one balloon to open up.
And then a second balloon to deliver that valve.
The second balloon puts the artificial valve in.
And they started doing it at Columbia. He's from Columbia. We do this cardiology conference that I'm going to brag.
I'm in charge of. It's got a good reputation.
I do this cardiology conference, thank you very much, every year at St. Joe's.
And I had him speak to us 2 weeks ago, and we had over 100 doctors and nurses and nurse practitioners, mostly, actually it's about 75 doctors, from all around Berks County. We had some from Hershey, we had some from Pottsville and Ashland, we had some from Pottstown, and they came to hear him speak about this, Dr. Leon. Now, this is being offered at University of Pennsylvania, but our hope is that within maybe a year, I think it might be about a year away, maybe, just maybe, we can get this in Berks County for those patients that need the surgery but are too sick to have the surgery. So that's who it is. If you're healthy, Dave, you just get the old-fashioned zipper, go in, they put in the new valve, you're good as new. So right now, this procedure is for patients that need the surgery but can't survive the surgery. But who knows? Maybe in 5 or 10 years it'll be for everybody. We don't know.
This has FDA approval and all that already, or
FDA,
we're still experimental?
It's in between.
Okay.
The studies show that it works. Right now, the FDA is only allowing it to take place at about, maybe 15 or so sites around the country. It is at Columbia in New York, and it is at Penn in Philadelphia. The FDA has not released it to other hospitals yet. So the FDA is keeping a very tight leash on it. The FDA has to approve every patient. Right now, every single patient has to be verified by the FDA as legitimate. So it's kind of somewhere between experimental and out there for prime time. It's kind of in between, but it's coming. And the studies show that it works. So it's a real deal. So it's coming. If you're a sick person and you need the surgery, we can send you to Columbia or Penn, but I'm hoping that in a year or two we can fix you right here in Berks County. That's the goal. That's the goal. Not quite yet, but it's very exciting, though. You know, as a cardiologist, I love it, the fact that, you know, it's a constantly evolving field, and I love bringing these national big shots to Berks County to teach us.
And you're going to be able, and it's a non-metal valve, so they're not going to be locked in with Coumadin.
Exactly right.
Which is one of the big, that's going to be the big thing on that.
Very exciting, Dave. The future is looking
good. I know
good.
We've talked about Coumadin before, and the fact that if you're on it, it's constant checks to make sure that all the balance and everything is working good.
So these are valves that don't need Coumadin. I just want to say it's very exciting. The future looks very exciting. So get in with your doctor. If you need to see a cardiologist, see one of us. We'll be happy to treat you.
Take your messages. Thanks again, as always. We'll see you in 2 months. Thanks again. Dave Spector, Dr. Andy Waxler, we'll see you in 2 months.
I'm going to make my phone calls right now.